Right, this is an approach to investment appraisal, APV. This is an approach to investment appraisal. Which separate project cash flows? Which separate project cash flows? Which separate project cash flows? And allocate a specific discount rate to each type of cash flows. And allocate a specific discount rate to each type of cash flows. To each type of cash flows, depending on the risk attributable to that particular cash flow. Depending on the risk attributable to that particular cash flow. Right, this is different from NPV approach. This is different from NPV approach. This is different from NPV approach, which uses one discount rate for all project cash flows. This is different from NPV approach, which uses one discount rate, one discount rate for all project cash flows. Write this. APV is preferable to NPV because APV is preferable to NPV because APV is preferable to NPV because by separating project cash flows. By separating project cash flows, comma, by separating project cash flows, comma, the company managers will be able
Sorry, sir, I muted you by mistake. I wanted to mute Yanano. May you kindly unmute your microphone?
Okay. So I was saying APV approach helps managers to understand which part of the project is generating which part or which proportion of value. Then I said open brackets and say APV approach allows managers. APV approach allows managers. APV approach allows managers to determine the value created from investment of shareholders' funds. To determine the value created from the investment of shareholders' funds.
Na Melinze.
Sorry? Well, so what am I saying? I'm saying APV approach helps managers to determine the value created from the investment of shareholders' funds and the additional value created from the manner in which the project is financed and additional value created from debt financing Right, that's APV. I'm sure what what I've been saying, some of you perhaps you are saying you are just dictating, but we don't even have a clue of what the heck are you talking about. So allow me to explain in a manner that you guys will understand it. You know, I'm sharing my screen. We have what is called APV approach to investment appraisal. APV approach to investment appraisal. You know, this approach is very easy when you are appraising projects. It's different from NPV. You know, guys, NPV. NPV is when you just come up with cash flows, discount them using company's cost of capital or project specific cost of capital, and then you have your NPV. Now, APV is different in that APV argues that a project has got two sets of cash flows. There are cash flows which arise as a result of the manner in which the project is financed by debt. We call these financing cash flows. And there are cash flows which arise from the project itself, which we call investment cash flows. So APV then says investment cash flows should be discounted using investment specific cost of capital because there's no debt there. And then financing or debt cash flows should be discounted using the cost of debt. In so doing, we can, if we add to these together, we then have adjusted present value. So adjusted present value involves two main steps. You know, there are two main steps involved. Steps involved. You can write this. Steps in computing APV. Steps in computing APV. There are two main, just the two main steps involved. Step one. You calculate the best case NPV. That's the first step. Calculate the base case NPV. You calculate the best case NPV. That's the first step. Put a dash and say, this is the NPV computed on the assumption that, this is the NPV computed on the assumption that the project is all equity financed. NPV computed on the assumption that the project is all equity financed. Right, you now understand best case NPV as the first step. Best case NPV means we assume that there is no debt financing and calculate NPV. So what it means is when you are computing best case NPV, NB, when you are calculating best case NPV, before NB, you just determine project cash flows as before, and discount them using ungeared cost of equity, ungeared cost of equity. So important. What do we mean by saying ungeared cost of equity? Ungeared cost of equity means cost of equity without debt, cost of equity without debt. That's ungeared cost of equity. Now you may say we are used to cost of equity. We are hearing this term now, ungeared cost of equity. Yes, you are right. You know what? If ungeared cost of equity is not given, write this. If ungeared cost of equity is not given, if ungeared cost of equity not given, comma, it is calculated using either of the form. It is calculated as follows. Calculated as follows. You know, if you are not given ungeared cost of equity, you have to estimate it. How do you estimate ungeared cost of equity? You simply, that's method number one. There are two methods to calculate it. Method one is to ungear the proxy firm's beta. Ungear the proxy. Ungear the proxy firm's beta to get asset beta. Get asset beta. You know, asset beta is ungeared beta. Ungeared beta. You remember, you are used to ungearing and regearing, as discussed in our cost of capital topic. What do you understand by ungearing? Ungearing means remove debt from the beta. Once you remove debt from the beta, you get what is called business risk or asset beta. If you are calculating cost of equity without debt, if you are given asset beta, don't go on to regear it. Remember, to regear is to introduce debt. You are calculating cost of equity without debt. So all you simply do is, after getting asset beta, meaning beta without debt, you then use asset beta in the CAPM formula, capital asset pricing model formula, to get cost of equity without debt. That's what you simply do. And so you're saying cost of equity without debt, which is K, can we say KE complement, that cost of equity without debt equals RF plus, but this will be asset beta bracket RM minus RF. You remember, you guys still remember that RM minus RF, it's known as the risk premium. You remember that? RM minus RF gives the equity risk premium. So if you are given the formula is risk premium, in other words, there's no need for you to say, suppose they say risk premium is 7%, There's no need for you to say RM minus RF. No. Because already that's the risk premium. That's the risk premium as it is. So you just say times 7%, beta times 7. If you have forgotten how to ungeared beta, you know, if you have forgotten ungeared beta, beta known as asset beta, you calculate it as follows. You say E over E over, you know, E is like proportion of value of equity over E plus D bracket 1 minus T. Then you multiply this times equity beta. Right. This is equity beta, say, of the proxy firm. All right. Of the proxy firm. So there you go. So that's how you ungear. Ungeared beta. So that's the formula there for asset beta, where E and D are the market values of equity and debt. And T is the tax rate. So that's how you ungear. Okay, I'm just answering this. Right, I'm done. So that's how you ungear. Now, Paddy, if I may ask, or Tichaona, if I may ask, suppose you are given asset beta, is there any need to ungear it?
Ungear it.
Pardon?
There's no need to ungear it if you are given the asset beta.
Yes. If you are given asset beta, the process of ungearing is not necessary. Because remember, to ungear is to get asset beta. So they can actually say business risk is measured by a beta of 1.8. So business risk is what is called asset beta. So if you use asset beta, means beta without debt. So if you use beta without debt in the cost of equity formula, you get cost of equity without debt, simple as that. And we call that ungeared cost of equity. You get that? Ungeared cost of equity. So when you are calculating base case NPV, meaning NPV on the assumption that the company is financed 100% by equity, when you are calculating it, make sure you discount with cost of equity without debt. If that cost of equity is not given, this is how you calculate it. Method one. Method two of calculating cost of equity without debt. Method two, you make KE complement like KE with that hyphen there. subject, not don't write unique per se. You simply say find KE complement. Find KE complement from the cost of equity formula, from the cost of equity of a geared firm, from the cost of equity or a geared firm formula below. So there is a formula for the cost of equity of a geared firm. Let me open it. Let me open any paper, question paper. There is a formula for the cost of equity with debt, and there's a formula for the for cost of equity without debt. So this is the formula. You can copy it. KE equals the one at the top. KE equals right? Make sure I have copied it nicely. This is the cost of equity formula, and it is as per Modigliani and Miller proposition 2 with taxes. It says, since you know cost of equity is calculated like KE. So let us name this, right? This where KE is the cost of equity for the geared firm. KE is the cost of equity for the geared firm. And then KE complement, KE with a small I there, just put it as a hyphen. KE complement is the cost of equity. Is the cost of equity for an ungeared firm, meaning without debt. KE complement is the cost of equity for an ungeared firm. And KD is the cost of debt. KD is the cost of debt. T is the tax rate. T is the tax rate. VD is the value of debt. VD is the value of debt. And VE is the value of equity. VD is the value of debt, and VE is the value of equity. VD is the value of debt, and VE is the value of equity. So it's not even difficult to calculate KE complement, meaning cost of equity without debt, if you are given relevant information. Let us just see if we can calculate it. Let us say illustration. You are given this information. You are given debt to equity ratio. Debt to equity ratio equal debt to equity ratio. Let's say is 40s to 60. That's debt to equity ratio. Then cost of equity. Cost of equity. Equity for the geared firm. For the geared, we say firm or geared project. Cost of equity for the geared project is 22%. Cost of debt. Cost of debt. Cost of debt is 8%. 8%. Tax rate is 30%. Tax rate is 30%. Now, required calculate cost of equity for an ungeared project. Calculate of equity or an ungeared project. Ungeared project. The cost of equity for the ungeared project, which is, so the cost of equity for your for the ungeared project is what we refer to as KE complement. That's our. It means without debt, KE complement. Cost of equity for an ungeared project. You know what? Knowledge of cost of equity for an ungeared project is important because it is the one which you must use to calculate best case NPV. Remember, we are on step one where we say calculate best case NPV. This is just NPV computed as before, but the discount rate used is the cost of equity without debt. It's so important. So there is need for some workings somewhere. So I want you to use this formula here that you have copied to calculate KE complement. Remember, cost of equity with debt is KE, just KE, and it's 22%. So in the interest of time, let us do it together. So you say 22%, so these are like percentages. You can say 0.22 equals, you know, the formula says KE complement. So we have got, notice it says 0.22 equals KE complement. So you just put it like that, equals KEI plus open bracket 1 minus tax rate, which is 1 minus 0.3 close bracket open bracket KEI minus KD, which is KE complement minus KD minus 0.08, that's cost of debt close bracket, times VD over VE, which is 40 over 60. Right. Now what you then do, please pay attention. It is important to solve this bracket. How do we solve this bracket? We say 40 over 60. 40 over 60, you get 2/3. Now 1 minus 0.3, you get 0.7. So you are saying 2/3 times. Remember, brackets means times. All these figures are multiplying each other. So 2/3 times 0.7, I'm getting 0.447. So what I'm now doing is, if I say 1 minus 0.3 times 40 over 60, it comes out to 0.47. So I can now say 0.22 equals KE complement plus 0.47 bracket KE complement minus 0,08. Follow me through now. So I have to simplify the bracket there. So it becomes 0,22 equals KE complement, KE complement plus 0,47 KE, 0,47 KE complement minus, I then say 0.47 times 0.08, I'm getting 0.0376, 0.03 or 0.04. Let me just say 0.04 to round it to after rounding it to. So notice. The equation then says, it then says 1,47, or I can say 0,22 plus 0,04 equals 1,47 KE complement. This is basic maths. So after solving it, KE complement, meaning cost of equity without debt, becomes plus 0.22. So it's like 0.22 plus 0.04. You get 0.26 divided by 1,47. 1,47 equals 17.7% equals 0,177, 0,177 or 17.7%. So 17.7%, or you can simplify it to 18%. So 18% will be the cost of equity that you then use to discount the project. This is the cost of equity without debt. So there are two different types of cost of equity. There is cost of equity with debt, and there is cost of equity without debt. So cost of equity without debt is the one which we use to calculate base case NPV. Why? Because base case NPV, by definition, it is NPV that we calculate on the assumption that the project is 100% financed by equity. So we take out everything to do with debt. So you have it. So no wonder why you have that formula in the formula booklet. This one, the KE formula. This is how you may use it, should the examiner so chooses. You know, debt to equity ratio, we have given it as 40:60. You can be given it as 30%. So outside the bracket, instead of VD over VE, you simply say 0,3. If you are given it as 30%. Right? That was step number one. Then let us go to step two. Step two, when you are calculating APV, step two involves calculate the present value of debt financing cash flows. Calculate the PV of debt financing cash flows. Debt financing cash flows. PV of debt financing cash flows. So you first calculate best case NPV and then find PV of debt financing cash flows. To sum it up, PV of debt financing cash flows Now, how then do we maneuver to calculate PV of debt financing cash flows? Pay attention to this step, so important. You know, they include, let me put numerals. One, they include issue costs. We put a dash and say these are incurred in year zero. These are incurred in year zero. In year zero. Now, where you say calculate PV of debt financing cash flows, open brackets, just open brackets and say discount using cost of debt. Discount using its cost of debt or normal borrowing rate or normal borrowing. Discount using cost of debt or normal borrowing rate. Right, let me bold it. Discount using cost of debt or normal borrowing rate. Right? This is so important. You cash flows to do with debt are not discounted using cost of equity. Remember, on our definition of APV, we said APV separate cash flows. Those to do with debt and those to do with. So issue costs are incurred in year zero. So these ones are straightforward. Number two, there is tax benefit on interest. Tax benefit on interest. Now, when you are calculating tax benefit on interest, two things arise. There are two aspects to consider here on tax benefit on interest. We have got an amortized loan. For an amortized loan, proceed as follows. For an amortized loan, comma, proceed as follows. If you are told that the loan is amortized, you proceed as follows. First, prepare the loan amortization table to get interest. Prepare the loan amortization table. Prepare the loan amortization table to get annual interest. To get annual interest. Annual interest. That's what we used to remember how the loan amortization table is prepared. If you have forgotten, we may do a question with that so that you see. Then calculate tax benefit on interest. Tax benefit on interest as follows. You then calculate tax benefit on interest as follows. You say interest from the table, from amortization table times tax rate, then this interest from amortization table times the tax rate, then open bracket and say then discount normal borrowing rate. So when you are saying interest from the amortization table times tax rate, I can bold it and again put it in red so that you see it nicely. That's an amortized loan. Remember, an amortized loan is a loan in which you are paying both interest and principal at the same time. Then, for a loan which is not amortized, for a loan which is not amortized, what is such a loan? We are saying where interest is the same every year, where interest the same every year, where interest is the same every year. How do we go about it? You say a tax benefit on interest is calculated as follows. Tax benefit on interest is calculated as follows. Now, this is for a loan which is not amortized, a loan in which interest is the same every year. You simply say loan amount times interest rate times tax rate. Loan amount times interest rate times tax rate. And then this one, brackets and say then discount as an annuity. As an annuity at normal borrowing rate. Normal borrowing rate. You discount this as an annuity. The reason why you discount this as an annuity is because interest is not changing. Every year, interest is the same. So you discount it as an annuity at normal borrowing rate. Like that. Right? C. C. There is again another issue to consider here when you calculate. There is a subsidized loan. Subsidized loan. What is a subsidized loan? Who can I ask? Yes, Patty. Yanano, tell me what is subsidized loan? You can unmute and talk to yourself. What do you understand by a subsidized loan? Okay. Pat, you can assist. What's a subsidized loan?
I think a subsidized loan is a loan in which you don't pay the interest. I don't think you'll be paying the market rates. You'll be paying a bit lower interest compared to market rates, and probably the other part of the interest will be covered, probably to be a government subsidy or something covering
Yes.
the balance.
You are right. A subsidized loan, put a dash and say, where the firm pays interest below the market rate of interest, pays interest which is below the market rate of interest. Loan. You pay interest which is below the market rate of interest. So for our analysis, let's say you are writing as I'm putting it. Let's say market rate is RM, market rate is RM, capital letter R, and subsidized rate is RS. Is RM for market rate and RS for the subsidized rate, in the interest of what we are going to discuss here. So there are two types of benefits for a subsidized loan. Two types of benefits emerge. There is what is called subsidy benefit. Subsidy benefit. How do we calculate it? Subsidy benefit equals, say, subsidized loan times RM minus RS. You know, a subsidy benefit, it's like normal borrowing rate is 4% and you are paying 1.5%. So it means the difference is a benefit to you. Actually, it is benefit and must be declared for tax purposes. So it is taxed. So you say times open bracket 1 minus T, meaning you then get what is left. Then you say then discount at normal borrowing rate. Discount as annuity at normal borrowing rate. So even if it's a subsidized loan, notice it is discounted as an annuity at normal borrowing rate. That's about subsidy benefit. This is one type of a benefit that you get for a subsidized loan. You know, there is subsidy benefit. Now, for a subsidized loan, there's another benefit also, which is tax benefit on interest. Tax benefit on subsidized loan interest. Tax benefit on subsidized loan interest. So this is, you know, you simply say, so you now understand subsidy benefit. The fact that you are paying a lower tax rate, there's a benefit. And that benefit must be declared for tax purposes. And so no wonder why we are saying 1 minus T, meaning you get what is left after tax. Then there is tax benefit on subsidized loan interest. How do you go about it? You simply say subsidized loan times RS, meaning subsidized rate, times tax rate. What then do you do? Then discount as annuity at normal borrowing rate. Discount is annuity at normal borrowing rate. Now you may say, why is it on everything we are saying discount? Because we want to find the PV. Notice step two. Step two, where you have written step two, you said calculate PV of debt financing cash flows. What we are calculating is the PV. So it's one thing to find the tax benefit on interest, but it's another to find its PV. To find its PV is now to discount. No wonder why at every point I'm saying discount using, for the purpose of you knowing that what we are calculating here is the PV. Right. Then there is D. Increased debt capacity. You know, write this. As a result of the project, comma, the firm's capacity to borrow may increase. You know, it's possible that if you do project, it increases value to the firm to the extent that your capacity to borrow can even now increase because of that project. So imagine you are not doing any project and you approach a bank for a loan. You'd notice the bank may say, we can't give you the loan because you don't have capacity to repay it. But suppose you then begin to do your poultry project or tobacco farming project, and then you approach the same bank and tell them that you have got tobacco farm which is flourishing as we speak. Can you borrow me money? They will now borrow you money because of the project. So a project can increase debt capacity. Now write this. Whether the additional debt is borrowed or not, comma, we must calculate whether the additional debt is borrowed or not. We must calculate the tax benefit on increased debt capacity. So there's what is called tax benefit on increased debt capacity. We don't even bother whether they have taken the additional debt or not, but as long as the capacity to borrow is increased, it's a relevant thing because it is as a result of the project. So what we then do is we say increased debt capacity. You say increased debt capacity, meaning additional loans possible, multiply by normal interest rate. Rate multiply by tax rate, then discount at normal borrowing rate. So there you go. You will like it. I know you will like it. Right. So there you go. And this is what I wanted us to cover. This is all what APV is all about. So let us do questions. What I'm going to do is I'm sending the question on our WhatsApp, on our Skype here. I'm sending the question on our Skype, if you can have it. You can access it from the chat feature. December 2018 question. There are plenty of questions you can actually do on APV. December 2018 question. I've sent it to you. I'm sure I have this question ready. I have this paper ready, opened. Let me check which question is that. Question number three. Amber Lee Company. Can you begin reading it? Just give me a minute, I'm coming. Read Amber Lee Company. I will take it up from there. I'm coming. Right, guys, I'm back. So what we want to do is to answer the Amber Lee question. I know you have read. If you don't mind, allow me to just read as well and see how it goes. Amber Lee Company is a listed company with divisions which manufactures cars, motorbikes, and cycles. Over the last few years, Amber Lee has used a mixture of equity and debt finance for its investment. However, it is about to make a new investment of $150 million in facilities to produce electric cars, which it proposes to finance solely by debt finance. Project information. Amber Lee's finance director has prepared estimates for the post-tax cash flows for the project using a four-year time horizon together with the realizable value at the end of 4 years. Now, notice. These are cash flows after tax. You may as well calculate them yourself. The same way you calculate project cash flows. Remember, these are like net cash flows. So if these are net cash flows, it means be prepared in an exam to find an APV question where you have to calculate everything from inflating cash flows, you know, from finding sales revenues, operating costs, a working capital, capital allowances, until you get to net cash flows. So the examiner has already done all that donkey work for you. He has already calculated everything, and what you have here is just the net cash flows. And we are told that these are post-tax cash flows. Now, the working capital of $6 million is not included in the estimates above. So these estimates doesn't include working capital. And then, so what it means is, if these are post-tax operating cash flows, meaning they have already done sales, less cost of sales, a tax benefit on capital allowances, or tax allowable depreciation. Everything was already done. So if you are given inflation, there's no need to inflate these cash flows because everything was already done to get them. If these are net cash flows, if we can agree that these are net cash flows, if you are later given inflation, there's no need to inflate them. How would you inflate a net cash flow? All right, and then they are saying working capital of $6 million has not been included in the estimates above and funded from retained earnings will also be required immediately for the project, rising by predicted rate of inflation each year. Any remaining working capital will be released in full at the end of the project. So these inflation figures here that we are given are just given for the purpose of inflating working capital, not those cash flows. The finance director has proposed the following finance package for the new investment. So this is the finance package for the new investment. A bank loan repayable in equal installments over the project's life. Interest payable at 8%. Now, if they say a bank loan repayable in equal installments, if they give you this statement here, it means the loan is amortized. You know, at your level, I told you last week that when we're doing bonds, that at times there is no word amortization. The examiner expects you to know that if we say the loan is repayable in equal annual installments, what does that mean to you? It means the loan is being amortized. So this is an amortized loan. And then a subsidized loan from a... So normal borrowing rate is 8%. That's what it means. Normal borrowing rate is 8%. Then there is a subsidized loan from a government scheme over the project's life on which interest is payable at 3.1%. Per year. So there's another subsidized loan. So subsidy benefit is the difference between 8% and 3.1%. So these are the two debt packages that they have. Issue costs will be 3% of gross proceeds on the subsidized loan. So issue costs are only on the subsidized loan. No issue costs will be payable on the bank loan. So on the bank loan, meaning on the 70 million, there's no issue costs. Additional information. Amberley pays tax at a rate of 30% on profits in the same year in which they arise. Amberley's company asset beta is 1.4. Now, because we are already told that this is asset beta, there is no need for you to anigia. If it was said Amberley company's equity beta is 1.14, then you would anigia it, because equity beta has got both debt and a business risk. It has got both financial risk and business risk. So you are given this information to calculate cost of equity without debt. Why do you say cost of equity without debt with this information? If you are given asset beta, it means you are given beta without debt. So if you use beta without debt in the compound formula, the cost of equity that you get is the cost of equity without debt. Simple. Then Amberley's chairman has noted that all of the company's debt, including the new debt, will be repayable within 3 to 5 years. He is wondering whether Amberley needs to develop a longer-term financing policy in broad terms and how flexible this policy should be. Right. And then calculate the adjusted present value for the project and conclude whether the project should be accepted or not. Now, in the notes, where I was giving you the notes, there was the last point that I think I left out. In the last point, in the notes, you then say adjusted present value. The last point is adjusted present. Adjusted present value equals best case NPV, meaning NPV on the assumption that the project is all equity financed, plus PV of debt financing cash flows. This is how you calculate adjusted present value, APV. That's how you calculate it. It just involves two steps. First, calculate best case NPV, and then after getting best case NPV, find PV of debt financing cash flows. Add them together, you are done. That's adjusted present values. So I have told you why this is preferred. We discussed this at the beginning. Why APV is preferred? It's because instead of just calculating NPV, APV separates cash flows. Investment cash flows, meaning cash flows generated by the project, are discounted using cost of equity without debt to see how much the investment of shareholders' funds have generated. And you get best case NPV. And then you also need to see how much value was created from debt financing. So that's PV of debt financing cash flows. Add them together. The answer you get is adjusted present value. So let us answer. Allow me to. I may not open another sheet. Yeah, I may just write in your notes illustration December 2018 question 3. The question is Amber Lee. Amber Lee Company. You know, I know you're doing it in your notebooks, but I am typing on Excel. So what I'm trying to, what you then see when I'm typing on Excel, it's the fact that this is how you do it in your exam. The manner I type it here on Excel is basically how you do it in the exam. So if I may put a line here to indicate that my notes are done. Right, so this is now the illustration. It says calculate APV. So A, open bracket and say A. APV equals, so that's how you put it. APV equals, you say best case NPV, best case NPV plus PV of debt financing side effects or debt financing cash flows. Debt financing cash flows. This is how you calculate APV. Then you skip about four lines and say workings. Everything that I was talking about there at the top are workings. In the exam, you don't say step one. It would be rather convenient to tell the examiner that you say working one, best case NPV, best case NPV. You now know what best case NPV is. Best case NPV is NPV from an all equity financed project. NPV from an all equity financed project. Equity financed project. Get that? NPV from an all equity financed project. That's a best case NPV. The project is 4 years. So for at this stage, we don't include anything to do with debt. We don't even put anything to do with debt there. Please know that. So you say year 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. You know, if these cash flows are referred to as post-tax, it means they are after-tax. That's what post-tax means. Post-tax means. So year 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. And then we say, let me expand this. These are millions. Observe, you know, there's need to observe neatness when you're doing these things. Don't just answer anyhow. There's an element of professionalism when you're presenting answers at your level, at strategic level. There is inherent assumption that you are a professional person. So the manner in which you perform your calculations, the manner in which you do your stuff must reflect to a degree a certain element of professionalism. Not just working things anyhow. There's no format, we don't even know where you are going, where you're coming from. No. So you can see, as you say, that I'm very neat. So how do we go about it? We say post-tax operating cash flows. Post-tax operating cash flows. Operating cash flows. Now, you know, the examiner has given us these cash flows as post-tax, but in other exams, in other questions, you may actually need to calculate them yourself the same way you calculate cash flows for a project. To say sales, less cost of sales, I mean direct costs, less, you know, fix the costs if they are incremental. If they need to be inflated, you inflate them as before. You inflate the cash flows when appropriate until you get to this level. After taking out tax allowable depreciation, take after deducting tax, all this and you get to this point. Now the examiner has already done all that for you. So post-tax cash flows are 28.5, 36.7, 28.5 in year 1, 36.7 in year 2, then in year 3, 44.4 and 50.9. So there you go. Then you say initial cost. Or let's say incremental working capital first. Incremental working capital. And then we have initial cost. Initial cost slash residual value. Initial cost and residual value. So the initial cost of the project is 150 million. That's the initial cost. You may say 150 million aren't they the loans? Yes, if you are told that the loans are required to finance the project, it means the project is equal to the amount of the loans. Or on the introduction here, you are told that the investment required is 150 million. So you can you say initial cost 150 million minus 150, and then residual value is given 45. Residual value is the realizable value, the amount that this thing will be sold at the end. So residual value is 45. Now, incremental working capital, what you can do is you can actually have a working. So you can say working 2. This is how you develop your workings. Don't leave lines for now because you don't know when this will take you. So it will be prudent to first say net cash flows. You are adding these columns and up to here. That's your net cash flows. Remember, the working capital column is not yet there. So please don't put your net cash flow figures yet because they are going to change if you put working capital. So after putting working capital, then you put net cash flows. Don't put those figures yet because working capital is yet to be included there. Then you say present value interest factor. At that discounting factor. Discounting factor, remember, it's cost of equity without debt. So this is working number 3. So just say present value interest factor at and put a space and say working 3. We are going to calculate cost of equity without debt. This is what we use to discount here. Cost of equity without debt, and then here you have got PV, and then you then say best case NPV equals sum of PVs. Best case NPV equals sum of PVs, which is equals 2. So you'd notice PVs, you'll be multiplying here, multiply by what we have here. After calculating the discounting factor, we shall have it. So for now, it will put 000, but it will update, don't worry. Equals sum. You are seeing how we do it on Excel. You don't leave space, otherwise you may not leave enough lines. So you proceed like this. And then say remember we are all these are workings. So we are now on working 2. Working 2 is incremental working capital. Incremental working capital. Incremental working capital. You still calculate it the same way you calculate, remember, the same way you calculate working capital from your FM. Year, you have year 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. Then 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. Then you say working capital level. Working capital level. You come to the question, what is it that it is telling us concerning working capital? They are saying working capital of 6 million has not been included. So it is required immediately. When they say working capital is required immediately, meaning from year zero. So working capital level in year zero is 6 million. Then it is going to grow by this inflation. It's going to grow by inflation levels. So if it is going to grow by inflation, you can actually working capital level, let me say in year one, let me put 6 million under year one. But when you are saying cash flow underneath, then you shall put it in year zero. So let us grow it by the inflation, guys. Can we grow 6 million by inflation? By inflation. If you say 6 times 1.08, you don't remove it from the calculator, it becomes 6.48. Right? The same figure, which is 6.48, grow it by times 1.06. Grow it by times 1.06. What do you get? The same, after grow, if you grow it by 1.06, you are multiplying 6.48 by the inflation of year two, which is 1.06, I'm getting 6.87. 6.87. The same figure, 6.87, I then have to multiply it by the inflation of year. What is the inflation? 5% times 1.05. I get what? I'm getting 7.21 as the figure in year 4, 7.21. Now what I then have to do is, this is working capital level. It's not a cash flow. Remember, from your Fin 3 or financial reporting, if debtors increase from, we said if debtors increase from 30 million to 38 million, and you were asked the cash flow, you were taking only the increase, you would say cash out of 8. If debtors decreased, you would say cash in. You take the incremental, that is the cash flow that you put. So you come here and say incremental working capital, or so incremental working capital becomes the cash flow. That's the cash flow. So in year zero, what happens is you need to invest 6 million in working capital. So it's minus 6. In year zero, it's minus 6 because you are starting from zero and you need to invest 6 million. But going forward, you then say equals, like if you want year one. Remember, it is required at the beginning, meaning the one for year two is required end of year one. So you say 6 minus 6.48 to take the incremental, because it has increased, so it's a cash outflow, it's a negative. You get that? Then in the final year, they are telling us that working capital will be released in full at the end of the project.
This so, is sorry, sir.
Yes,
sorry, sir, to take you back. I think I'm a bit confused. in terms of the incremental working capital, I was assuming that from year zero to year one, the working capital should have increased by six.
Not really. Working capital of six, it's actually in year zero, but it is simply required at the beginning of year one. So it is working capital for year one, required at the beginning of year one. No wonder why when we come to working capital level here, we are putting it in, to incremental working capital, we are putting it in year zero. Alternatively, I can copy this whole thing here and show it to you in another way by pasting it on the side. I can as well say, so this is here. Let me show it an alternative presentation. So I can take my working capitals here, cut them here, and paste them from year zero, so that in year four they will be zero like this. So you would notice that this is a rather loose way of saying exactly what we are saying here, that the working capital in year zero level is six, but this is working capital for year one required at the beginning. So this is what the table on your left is telling you. So the table on your left, if the figures indicated, they mean the same thing with the table on your right, like this. But the table on your right is not necessarily correct. But still, it hammers the point home. The table on your left is telling you that working capital for year one is 6 million required at the beginning. The table on your right is now saying working capital for year zero. You know, there's no working capital for year zero. No wonder. It is actually working capital for year one required at the beginning. So the table on your left is saying it out more nicely than on the right, though they mean the same thing. I'm sure I've explained. So you choose whichever way you want. We mark both of these correct. All right? But you talk to me. You say I've understood you.
Unfortunately, not. I'm still vexed by this.
Which part exactly is still vexing you?
The fact that we are saying the working capital it's minus six in year zero. Because my
The
line of
cash
thinking,
flow.
yeah, the cash flow.
Yes.
My line of thinking was that the incremental cash flow was minus six should be in year one.
Ah, no. It should be near zero because it is required at the beginning. When we say year one required at the beginning, what does that mean?
So is there any scenario that the cash flow is maybe needed at the year end?
When it comes to working capital, it is customary. It's rare to have working capital required at the end. Imagine a situation where you have a boutique. You first order goods before you sell. Isn't it
Yes.
so? So
Yes.
that's the line of thinking. Working capital is normally required at the beginning so that you can get things started.
So if it's that case, shouldn't it be six in the working capital level should be six in years there, is it?
Exactly, and that's what we have done.
Incremental part.
Yes.
If it's six in year zero, Then in year one, it's 6 again.
No. No. If we go by any of the tables, should we go by the table on the right? Perhaps it makes you understand better. The table on the right is saying level in year zero is six. What it means is you have invested six. No wonder why cash flow is negative six. Agreed
all
on
right,
that part?
All right. Yes.
Then the six, you want it to increase by inflation to 6.48. So the incremental is 0.48 and so forth.
Yeah, I think I get the jinx of it now.
Right. Now, when they say working capital is to be released in final year, it means in final year it has to be zero. So it must drop from 7.21 to zero. So it will be cash in. You recover your working capital. It's like you have your boutique and the project is over. You don't just lock doors with clothes inside. No. You have to sell the remaining inventory. That is called recovery of working capital or releasing of working capital. Right. Then let us go to working number three. Right. When you are calculating base case NPV, notice the cost of equity is the cost of equity without debt. Because base case, it's like an all equity finance the project. So the cost of equity there is the cost of equity without debt. So we call it ungeared cost of equity. Cost of equity. That's the cost of equity you use, ungeared cost of equity. Now, remember what I said, you use CAPM formula, capital asset pricing formula. You say I have the formula at the top. I can just go back and copy it because I want to show you. This one is the formula. I said you say KEI, meaning KE complement, ungeared. The complement means without debt or ungeared. So ungeared cost of equity from our discussion here, ungeared cost of equity equals. So you say KEI equals. Now, a key important point here is, if you were not given asset beta, you would have to ungear it first. You have to ungear. If you were given equity beta, you have to ungear to get asset beta. But because we are already given asset beta, so it's easy then. So this then follows naturally and say equals. RRF is the risk-free rate. You are given that the risk-free rate is 4%. So that's your risk-free rate. You put 4%. 4% plus beta asset or asset beta, 1.14. That's the beta. But if I'm saying if it was equity beta, you would first ungear it. And then market return is 11. So remember, it's RM minus RF, which is 11% minus RF 4%. That's CAPM formula. So ungeared cost of equity then becomes KE complement becomes, you have your calculator there. Inside the bracket is 7. So 1.14 times 7 equals plus 4. I'm getting 11.98 or 12%. So it's 11.98%, which is equals to 12% for the purpose of discounting. So here we are going to discount with 12%. You make use of tables to get your discounting factors. In year zero, it's one. You all know that. So because I'm using Excel, I can simply say this over 1.12. It's another way of getting the figures from tables. Like this. Done. I can round them to three decimal places, the discounting factors to three decimal places, because in the, this is just in the interest of compliance with what you already know. Right. So there you go. So best case NPV becomes 5.15. That's best case NPV. It's 5.15 million. You are getting it. 5.15 million. You can customize it just to make sure that it's negative there. All right. So always, as a point of emphasis, the examiner gave us post-tax cash flows, but remember, you can work them out from this, from the start. Starting from sales, inflating sales, cost of sales, inflating cost of sales, through to that line of net cash flows. So the now, next is, that's now step two, but you continue with workings. You say PV of debt financing cash flows. Debt financing. Now I want you everything that I had said. Can you read for me what I had said in the notes so that I will follow through what you are reading? On PV of debt financing cash flows, we said what do we do? Issue costs, that was our starting point, right? Issue costs. So we do have issue costs. Issue costs. Or let me put it this way, in the interest of neatness. Yeah, you've got 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, and then you also have year 1 to 4. In this one is where we put something which is in an annuity, and 1, 2, 3, 4 is where we put the cash flows which are not annuities. So we have got year 1, 2, 3, 4 and year 1 to 4. So what we do is we have got issue costs. Costs. Please pay attention to neatness. When you are doing this, you have to be very neat, and your presentation should show professionalism. So issue costs are like this. They are 3% of gross proceeds. You know what? They are on subsidized loan. Now, our subsidized loan is 80 million. And you are told that issue costs are 3% of gross proceeds. It does not mean issue costs are 3% of 80 million. 80 million is what is left after deducting issue costs. So 80 million is 97%. If issue costs are 3%, after deducting issue costs, you are left with 80 million. It means 80 million is 97%. So here, issue costs becomes, open bracket and say, 3 over 97 times 80 million times 80. And we put them in here, 0 equals minus 3 over 97 times 80. That's your issue costs. Actually, let me just try to put everything here to two decimal places. Put everything here to two decimal places so that I won't be adjusting each and every figure here. All right? So issue costs are negative. Remember? Let me put them like that so that you can see clearly. What else is there? There is a subsidy benefit. Subsidy benefit. subsidy benefit. Alright? Subsidy benefit. Now, concerning subsidy benefit, there is something that we need to know. When is tax rate paid? They are saying tax is paid on in the same year in which profits arise. So it's important. I will write it as an important NB later. Subsidy benefit. Now, subsidy benefit, you know, normal borrowing rate is 8% and your subsidized loan rate is 3.1%, meaning the difference is the subsidy benefit. So remember we said, you say open bracket 80 million times another bracket 8% minus 3.1% close bracket times 1 minus tax rate 1 minus 0.3, meaning this is income to you and it is taxed, so you get what is left. That's what it means. 8 minus 3.1, it's 4.9, so the benefit is 4.9. So you are saying 0.049 times 80 times 70 times 0.7. What I'm getting is 2.74. This comes under year 1 to 4. It's an annuity. 2.74. This is an annuity because it is a subsidy benefit every year. So it comes under year 1 to 4. So 1 to 4 is for those which happen to be annuities. Then we have got tax benefit on subsidized loan interest. Tax benefit on subsidized loan interest. Yes, tax benefit on subsidized loan interest. How do we calculate this? We say 80 million, which is the subsidized loan, times 3.1%. Times tax rate, which is 30%, times tax rate, 30%. So you're saying 80 times 3.1 times 0.3. Okay, it's 80 times 80 times 0.031 times 0.3. I'm getting 0.74. So this comes under annuities. It comes under annuities equals 80 times 3.1% times 0.3, 0.74. Then we say tax benefit on amortized loan interest. Tax benefit on amortized loan interest. Amortized loan int. Tax benefit on amortized loan interest. So you say interest from, you say interest from amortization table times tax rate. Interest from amortization table times tax rate. Now, we need to calculate amortization table. That's what we need to prepare amortization table. So this is now working for. You know, working, they just come naturally like that. This now becomes working four. We shall come to working four. As I said, there's no debt capacity, there's nothing. So there's no increased debt capacity. If it was there, you'd continue doing that. So you would notice in the notes, we're saying some you discount as annuities, some as normal. like debt capacity, it depends on whether it is amortized, subsidized loan, discount as annuity, subsidy benefit, discount as annuity. If it, if the loan is not amortized, if it is amortized. So in this case, this particular loan here is amortized. So for us to get interest, we need to prepare amortization table. And please, I'm sure you still remember how an amortization table is prepared. So you have, you here you get net cash flow. Net cash flows, then you say present value interest factor at, right, on this one at 8%. You discount with normal borrowing rate, and at the top here we discounted with 12%. So it was PVIF at 12% at the top there on best case NPV, where we calculated the 12%. Now, on this one, debt financing cash flows are discounted with normal borrowing rate. So in year zero, it's one. In year one, it will be, you check from the tables. So it will be this divided by 1,08. Because I'm using Excel, there's no need for me to check from tables. You would notice. But there is need for me to check from tables on annuity. So 1-4, it's an annuity. I then have to check annuity 8% 4 years. I come to the tables. Where are your tables? Yeah. Annuity tables, 8% 4 years. So it's 3,312. So where it's written 1-4, 3,312. Have you noticed that 1-4 I used an annuity? This I didn't use an annuity. So we then have to, what we then get is the PV. You then get the PV there. You get the PV. And then you then PV of debt finance, PV of debt financing cash flows equals sum of PVs. Sum of PVs, which is equals to. So it's now a matter of saying equals sum. You are checking, guys, how I'm navigating my Excel functionalities, which is exactly what is required in the exam. Right. So what is required is working for loan amortization. Working for loan amortization. If the loan, you know, if you need to be able to tell your neighbor and say, where was it written amortized loan? Where was it written? It was written when they say the loan of 70 million payable in equal installments. Here, the loan of 70 million payable in equal installments over 4 years. That alone means the loan is going to be amortized. So, loan amortization. What do you do when you're calculating loan amortization? You first say annual installment equals, you know, you say the loan amount, which is 70 million divided by 70 million divided by annuity factor. You know, it will be PV annuity at 8%, which is the interest rate on the loan, 4 years, because it is paid over the project's life. So you do notice that it becomes what? It becomes This then becomes equals 70 million over 3,312. Remember, the annuity we have just checked on it is 3,312. And the annual installment then becomes equals 70 divided by the annuity. So 21 comma. So the annual payment is 21,14. Then we need this to prepare the table. So you say yeah. So now you then have amortization table. Amortization table. It is from this table where we now get the interest. You say yeah. Let us do it downwards. 1, 2, 3, 4. That's your year. 1, 2, 3, 4. And then, oh, sorry. All right, sorry for that. I wanted to put them at the middle like this. Then we have got opening balance. Opening balance. And you have got interest at 8%. Then you have got installment. And then you have got closing balance. You know, closing balance is like balance at the year end. So opening balance is your loan, which is 70. Interest is calculated on opening balance, which is equals to 0.08 times opening balance. Now, because you are doing it on Excel, you have to get it quickly. Then installment equals 2,14. That's installment. You get that? 2,14. Okay, sorry. Let me absolute reference it. So installment is 2,14. I can drag it. Right. And then closing. Actually, let me put in installment as negative minus this. Though I was going to. There you go. 2,14 negative. Then closing balance. You know, closing balance is the sum. Sum equals sum. Sum of this close bracket. All right. Let me put everything here to two decimal places to save time. All right. Notice opening balance, closing balance in year one is the opening balance in year two, like this. Closing balance in year one is the opening balance in year two. So you can now wrap it up. All right. So you can see it is amortized. It is amortized fully. So what we want when we are saying tax benefit on amortized loan, we wanted these figures. Tax benefit on amortized loan. So we said, you say interest from the amortization table times tax rate. So that's where that's what we are going to do now. So it's like in year one, it will be equals to interest in year one from the table, 5,6. Then you multiply that by the tax rate times 0.3. In year two, so this is not an annuity because, as you can see, interest is changing every year. So you can't have this as an annuity. So in year two equals 4,36 times 0.3. In year three equals 3,000 3,01, which is this figure here, times 0.3. In year 4 equals 1,57 times 0.3. Notice, teacher owner, that interest itself is not a cash flow, but the tax benefit thereon is the cash flow. Interest is never a cash flow in investment appraisal, but the tax benefit on interest is the cash flow. The tax benefit on interest. Notice also how I just brought everything together in one table for the purposes of calculation. Unlike a situation where you would actually have quite a lot of tables and a lot of one table is enough for you to perform your workings on this one. Equals this times, we now want to find PVs, this, enter, and then we drag and then put to two decimal places. There you go. So tax benefit on debt financing side effects is 12.8. So it's 12.8 million. That's the tax benefit on debt financing side effects, 12.8 million. So this is what we were looking for. And then let me bold it. Putting it in red does not mean it's negative, it's positive. I just want to make it prominent. So what you then have to do is you come to the top where we said APV equals best case NPV. So you are now saying best case NPV was, you can skip a line and say best case NPV was negative 5.15. It was minus 5.15 plus that one, we got it as 12.8. So your APV becomes, equals 12.8 minus, it's 12.8 minus 5.15. Your APV is 7.65 million. 7.65 million. Now let us try to interpret this. What does this mean? What does the 7.65 million mean? You know, APV, we said it separates cash flows. You have seen it clearly. There are cash flows which are known as investment cash flows. Those cash flows that arise from the project itself, have nothing to do with debt financing. So the project itself, as you can see, it is a negative NPV, meaning the shareholders' funds, if you are to invest with equity alone, suppose you are to use equity alone, you are going to reject this project. Because best case NPV is telling you that if you are to invest shareholders' funds alone, the project is not viable, as you can see. But after introducing debt, after you have introduced debt, notice how the project is now viable. So what APV teaches us is very simple. You know, when you're doing F9, you were always saying the NPV is negative, so the project must be rejected. You will now understand that there are certain things which cause NPV to be negative. Not because the project itself is not viable, but the manner in which the project is financed. So for this particular project, if we say we don't want any debt, notice, we are going to reject it. If we say on this project we don't want any debt, meaning all equity financed, we were going to reject it, as evidenced by best case NPV being negative. Now we have a finance manager a finance director. This finance director is a director who has now done P4, who knows that project's value can be increased, not because the cash flows have increased from a project, no. But value can be increased by the manner in which the project is financed. We like this particular manager. You know, these are the managers we want. These are the managers who know finance. They are now creating value, not because the project is now giving additional cash flows. No. They are now creating value by changing the financing package for the project. This splitting of cash flows and allocating different discount rates to these cash flows is what APV is all about. So APV helps you as a manager to see the value created by investment of shareholders' funds. Like in this case, if we invest shareholders' funds, the value is negative, meaning there is actually value destruction, not creation. But after altering or introducing debt into the equation, the whole thing becomes spectacularly good. Now, let me just put one NB in the notes. Right. Write this. If tax is paid 1 year in arrears, if tax is paid 1 year in arrears, comma, then if tax is paid 1 year in arrears, then the tax benefits are pushed back, in brackets, delayed by a year. The tax benefits are pushed back in brackets, delayed by a year. The tax benefits are pushed back or they are delayed by a year. Whenever tax is paid 1 year in arrears, the tax benefits are pushed back and delayed by a year. So, write this. The above table, write this. The above table on PV of debt financing cash flows would look like this. The above table on PV of debt financing cash flows would look like, would look as follows. If tax is paid 1 year in arrears, would look as follows. If tax is paid 1 year in arrears. So if tax is paid 1 year in arrears, if tax is paid 1 year arrears. So if tax is paid 1 year in arrears, this is how the same table above would look like. I just want to show you the years column. The years would be year. Instead, you put your year zero as before, but the tax benefits will start in year two. So you say 2, 3, 4, 5. And then the annuity will be 2 to 5. The annuity will no longer be 1 to 4. It will be 2 to 5. It will be 2 to 5. This is what your years column will look like. Your years column will look like. Now,
sorry, isn't it supposed to start from 1, not from 0 to?
No, issue cost will still go in year zero.
Okay.
Yes, issue costs will still go in year zero, but the tax benefits will start from year two. So year one will no longer be there. So everything that we have been doing, you put cash flows as they were, but starting from year two, apart from issue costs. That's one thing. Another thing, You may say, "Sir, we have understood you." So you are saying cash flows will be like 2, 3, 4. Yes, yes, that part we have understood it. But can you tell us how we pick an annuity from tables, which is written year 2 to 5? How is such an annuity taken from tables? Because, you know, all tables, when you were taking annuities from tables, you were always taking annuities like 1 to 10, 1 to 6, 1 to 8. Have you ever taken an annuity which reads 2 to 5? How do we take such an annuity? So if you want to, you to find an annuity which is 2 to 5 from tables, please pay attention here. You come to your annuity tables. You know, this annuity table that we took, like, it was 1 to 4. That's where we took 3, 3, 1, 2. It was 1 to 4. What if the annuity was 2 to 5? How were we going to pick it? When annuity is 2 to 5, it does not mean you pick annuity in year 5. No. It is 2 to 5, meaning we want 2, 3, 4, 5. We don't want year 1. Remember, annuity means cumulative NPVs. Let me repeat. Annuity means cumulative NPVs. In other words, NPVs are added together. I mean, cumulative PVs. The PVs are added together and accumulating. So the PV table here, this PV table here, if you cumulate these, to say this plus this, then you, the answer you get plus this, that is called to accumulate. If you accumulate these, you come up with an annuity table. So if an annuity is saying 2 to 5, it means it doesn't want year 1. So you say, because year 5 is cumulative, meaning it includes year 1. So if you want 2 to 5, you say 3,993 minus year 1. Why minus year 1? Because you need 2 to 5. Annuity means cumulative. So year 1 is included in year 5. So if it is not needed, it is deducted. Suppose I need an annuity which says 6 to 10, for example, at 8%. If the annuity had said 6 to 10 at 8%, because it needs 6 to 10. But if I come to year 10 here, this is accumulating from year 1. Annuity means cumulative PVs. So from year 1, everything is accumulating to year 10. If I need the 6 to 10, I just say year 10 annuity minus year 5 annuity. Because I need the 6 to 10, I don't need the 5 and back. So I would say year 10 minus year 5 if I need the 6 to 10. If I need 2 to 5, I would say year 5 minus year 1, because 1 is not needed. On this part alone, you will thank me later. On this part, during the course of your revision, you will thank me quite a lot. I know you will not call me to thank me, but it's a matter of playing the videos, because there are plenty of questions on APVs with that particular technicality. So that one is answered and sorted. So tax paid 1 year in arrears, you push back, meaning delay the years by a year. And then if you have to pick from annuity tables after pushing back by a year, that's how it goes. What else can I say? Allow me to utilize the remaining time perhaps to show you your exam. Your exam is computer based. The reason why I want to show you your exam is because come next week, we will now be starting assignments, and your assignments are on CBE practice platform format, meaning they exactly mirror how your exam will look like. So in terms of you answering the questions and stuff, you know what? Perhaps I need to emphasize on something. If you want to pass, you just do the assignments. Make no mistake, those who have been passing, they can tell you there's no secret to to passing than exam exposure. It's amazing how, as students, you think you can read on your own and pass, though that is a statement of fact. But there are certain exams where you give yourself up to unnecessary trouble. Just to do assignments. The beauty of assignments is the questions were carefully chosen. You, as a student, you don't have a you don't have capacity to choose questions which have got robust examinative effect. So you would notice that the efficacy of the time you are giving yourself is not that commendable. It's not that anything to write home about. No wonder why when we give you the assignments, we encourage you to do the assignment, because we have done the work for you of choosing which questions carry weight in terms of their relevance and the likely nature to groom you to be suitable for, to be competent for the exam. So you have that. So allow me now to show you this CBE practice platform. You know, the CBE practice platform, I'm sure you have it. You can access it from your MyAKA portal. And also try to make use of Africa Study Hub. There's a video that I compiled on Africa Study Hub, and I'm sure if I did send it in our main groups. Make sure you look it up and see how the Study Hub works. Africa Study Hub works. It's actually exceptional study convenience which ACCA has made available to Africa students. And you see it very, very helpful after playing that video that we did send. There are also webinars available on that on Africa Study Hub. Now, if you come to CBE practice platform, which is accessible from your MyAKA portal, if there's no assignment that we have sent to you, this will be your landing page. This is the landing page. And as you can see, assigned material, there's nothing. This emoji here means nothing. There's nothing. So after next week's lecture, over the course of this week, you will see that we will send you information requesting your details so that we can register you on CBE practice platform to begin to receive assignments and get busy right away. So because there's nothing assigned yet, you can come to the catalog tab and pick financial management and go to ACCA official resources and go to past exams. So these are your past exams. So I can assign December 2018 exam, this December 2018, by assigning it. It allows me then to do it. It comes to the left plane here. It's saying AFM past exam content. So I've assigned myself December 2018. Now you can see it is saying resume. It's saying resume because I once did it with your colleagues. I once did it with your colleagues. Oh, can I pick this one, September 2018, which is saying start? This is exactly how your exams look like, and I'm sure you are familiar with these functionalities. If you want to scroll next, if you want to click next, you have to scroll the entire page like this, scrolling to the end to click next. Yeah, I'm sure you are familiar with this, guys. If you are not, you are actually getting familiar as I'm doing it. You notice if I click next here, it doesn't allow me because it wants me to scroll to the end like this. Next. Now I all those were a list of instructions. Get used to them during the course of the study. You need not to read all the bunch of all those instructions in the exam. Otherwise, you spend 40-50 minutes reading them. Imagine 4 pages. So they are actually detailing how this whole thing works. So this is you then click next. Are you sure you want to start? Yes. And then click next. Right. So this is how it looks like. So this is there are 3 questions. So on the top right here, it's question 1 of 3. Don't say after answering this, you are done with the exam. This is question one of three. But unlike SBL, SBL, it will be the entire question on this page alone. SBL doesn't have them like this. But AFM, this is just question one. So don't think you have already. So as you can see, requirements here are telling you that this is just 50 marks. Remember, you are chasing 100 marks, so there are other two 25-mark questions. So on the left tab here are the case information for the questions, like the companies Washi Company. So you click here, you can read what Washi Company is all about, the introduction and everything. These are called exhibits. Funding information for whatever Washi Company wants to do. Additional notes. Aaron projects information, you click everything here, and then the requirements. These are the requirements. Now you can make your workspace clean by deleting unnecessary parts. So if you are done with the exhibits, you can close the exhibits. Please, still you can still highlight in the exhibit. Suppose you come across area where you feel this area will need it in answering, you can highlight it like this. If you close the exhibit, it does not mean the highlighting is eliminated. No, the highlight, notice I close the exhibit here, but if I come back to it, the highlighting is still there. So don't think you lose whatever you have highlighted by closing the exhibit. Otherwise, your workspace will be clustered. So this is what you do. And then remember, all computations are done. You choose how you want to answer all computations. If you come to requirements here, they say discuss how investing in overseas projects will help Washi gain competitive advantage over its competitors. So you notice all this is SBL stuff. Discuss the advantages and drawbacks of exchange traded derivatives contracts over compared with over the counter. So we shall discuss this part. Estimate the amount receivable, calculate net present value. So all this part, estimate the amount receivable, calculate net present value, preferred hedge method. These are called derivatives, and this is net present value. So you use spreadsheet, you pick spreadsheet here, and you know each and every question has got its own spreadsheet. So in this case, If the question is saying prepare a report to the board, and you pick the spreadsheet, it means this is appendices. You come here and type appendices. Appendices, because it's a report. You know, attached to the report are called appendices. So you perform all your workings like Japanese yen receivable under each hedging method. Japanese yen receivable, that's appendix one. Perhaps you can say appendix one, Japanese yen receivable under each hedging method, under each hedging method. So you can now use this to perform your computations. And after performing your computation, suppose you check what are the hedging methods they are talking about under each hedging method. So if you come to the question, funding and information, you are told that they want to hedge using forwards, they want to hedge using futures, they want to hedge using options. So after performing all your workings on spreadsheets, a pathway inside the report. Remember, the report is written nicely with a report format. Then you would say outcome, the hedge outcomes. You have already put the introduction for the report. You have already done everything. And then here you say hedge outcomes, because it's now report. So you say computations in appendix one, computations in appendix one. You know, this is how we now you reference computations in appendix one provides the following hedge outcomes. provides the following age outcomes. Outcomes. You know, by age outcomes, you are saying Japanese yen receivables. Japanese yen receivable under each aging choice. Receivable under each aging choice. Japanese yen receivable under each aging choice. Then you say, because it's now, computations are already there. So you say, forward outcome, you put the figure there to say JPY dash dash dash. You've already referenced it, so it's JPY XXX. Then futures age, get it nicely. That's how we put present points. JPY dash dash dash, and then options age, I will do with you all these because that's what comes under derivatives. Dash 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 dash. So you're done. You get that? So this is how the exam works, and you remember this is just an extract from the report. So the report will be continuing. It's not like this is the entire report, no. This is the report, part one of the report, which was just saying, part one was just saying, estimate the amount of Japanese yen receivable under each and additional debt finance needed. So it's a matter of just continuing working and make it and answer as said. We shall do these questions together. Now, another thing that I want to show you is where do you find tables? Some students may actually come out of the exam and say, I couldn't find tables. I know tables, but I couldn't find them in the exam. You come to the bottom left. If you click bottom left there, like what I have done, where they're saying help and formulae sheet, like that, there is workspace help. You know, workspace help means if you want to start to begin to study how the word process and the spreadsheet work, you can learn about it in the exam. But of course, you won't finish the exam to begin to study how the word processor, this word processor works, how the spreadsheet works. You will not finish the exam. Now, formulae sheet here. This is exactly this formula sheet that we have. You notice that in our physical exam, formula comes first. And then underneath the formula, there are tables. Because there's no table written tables here. So people may say, I couldn't find tables. They were just a formula sheet. No. Notice that underneath formula, there are tables. So that's where you get your tables. Your tables, as you can see nicely, all the tables that we've been using, that's where you get them. Please make sure where you get the tables so that it works. Remember, the video is recorded and streamed, so you still have the video throughout the course of your study. So I'm sure I'm done with showing you how the exam looks like. This is an ongoing thing. It's not like we won't show it again. I'll continue to show you. But the reason why I showed you this today is because of the pending assignments. Assignments are coming next week. So assignments are done on CBE practice platform. So make sure you be following what I've just said. If it's a report, all computations will be on word processor under appendices. And they have to be nicely referenced. I mean, all computations will be on spreadsheet under appendices, and they have to be nicely referenced to the report where appropriate. So there you go. Now, I want to give you a practice question and its marking scheme on APV, which is June 2014 question number two. If you don't mind, allow me to Allow me to send it to the WhatsApp group. Allow me to send it to the WhatsApp group. June 2014 question 2. Want you to practice that APV question. It appears I can't see its answer. June 2014, here's the question. Let me try to find the answer, because I want you to mark it for yourself. June 2014, question 2, right. Oh, well, the question paper has been left out again. Let me now send the question paper. June 2014, question 2. All right, so this is the instruction. As further practice. May you do June 2014 question two APV. Mark it yourselves. Using the marking scheme attached. Marking scheme attached. Right. Play today's video first. Play today's video first. Today's video first. So, right. So there you go. Fantastic stuff. Thank you for joining the lecture. Till we meet, pleasure and cheers.